Madeline! Oh, Augustus, I've such bad news. It's poor darling Hilda.
Hilda?
She's broken up with Watcher.
Watcher?
I must be with her in her hour of need.
But I can't go and see your godmother all by myself. Suppose she doesn't approve of me.
She'll love you, Augustus.
Excuse, sir.
Just as I do.
But I'll be all alone.
Oh, my brave, my wonderful boy. In you get now.
Club is really amazing, Jeeves.
Indeed, sir.
Now, don't sound so sooky, Jeeves. I thought you'd be pleased. It means you won't have to lug that great bag of clubs around anymore. This little chap is the whole works.
I should not wish to be seen carrying an illegal club around Wentworth, sir.
There's nothing in the rules of golf says one can't have an adjustable iron. You see, I just press this button here. Click, it's a niblick. Click, click, it's a mashy niblick. Click, 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 it's a mid-mashy. Click, 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 click.
Yes, thank you, sir. Most ingenious.
All the way up to click.
Rule number 14.3, sir, states that no player shall use any artificial device or unusual equipment. The Rules Committee of the Royal and Ancient are...
The Rules Committee of the Royal and Ancient are yesterday's men, Jeeves. They simply have to face up to the modern world.
If you say so, sir. Mr. Wooster's residence. Good afternoon, Mrs. Gregson. No, I regret to say that Mr. Wooster is not at home, Mrs. Gregson. Certainly, Mrs. Gregson. Yes, Mrs. Gregson. That was Mrs. Gregson, sir. She desires us both to visit her immediately.
And I say yes, Bertie.
Oh, but dash it, Aunt Agatha.
Please. Kind of confine that sort of language to the taproom where it belongs.
But Aunt Agatha, I don't even know this Gertrude Winkworth.
Her mother, Dame Daphne, is one of my oldest and dearest friends. There is good blood there, Bertie. An injection of it might fortify the jejune concoction, which seems to run through the veins of the Woosters these days.
Well, you're sure not suggesting that I just turn up on the doorstep of this Deverill Hall place and ask to marry their Gertie?
Her mother confided to me that Gertrude was being pursued by some quite unsuitable sort of actor of all things. I said to her, she is just the girl for Bertie.
That's another thing. If this Gertrude Winkworth and I should by some remote chance hit it off, we'd be known by all and sundry as Bertie and Gertie, like some dashed music hall act.
Don't be such a poltroon, Bertie. Get him down to Deverill Hall, Jeeves.
Very good, Mrs. Gregson.
Bertie, I've forgotten the address.
Gussie, whose address?
I can't remember. Dame something something.
Can't you telephone Madeline to find out where her dreaded godmother lives?
I don't know where Madeline is. Oh, at least I do. The Larches, Wimbledon Common. But I don't know the telephone number.
Well, that's all right. We can look it up. What's the name of this friend of hers?
Hilda. Oh, something.
Oh. Pardon me, sir?
Yes, Jeeves?
If it is to Miss Bassett's godmother that Mr. Fink-Nottle must present himself for approval, then I think you'll find that it is Dame Daphne Winkworth.
That's it? That's it?
How the dickens did you know that, Jeeves?
I heard Miss Bassett's father, Sir Watkin, mention that Miss Madeline's two godmothers are Dame Daphne and Mrs. Gregson. He referred to them in a moment of grim jocularity as Scylla and Charybdis.
And this is the same Dame Daphne Winkworth of Deverill Hall that we're under orders to see.
Indeed, sir.
Well, there you are then, Gussie. We can put you up for the night and you can travel down with us tomorrow.
Oh, no. Madeline would expect me to be there tonight.
Oh, assert your independence, Gussie. Anyway, how will she know that you're not? We could slide over to the drones for a snifter.
All right. Why shouldn't I? I will. Why should I do exactly what Madeline tells me all the time?
Spoken like a true Fink-Nottle, Gussie.
I don't go around telling her what to do.
True, true. Usual for me, please, George. What about you, Gussie?
Orange juice, please.
Come, Gussie, you're out on the long leash. You'll drink champagne and light. Casimir!
What? What ho, Bertie?
I haven't seen you in an age, Casimir. Do you know Gussie Fink-Nottle? Claude Potter-Pirbright. So what are you up to, Casimir?
Oh, I start rehearsing a new musical next week.
Yeah, nice part.
The usual. Bound on, act one, clutching a tennis racket and shout, hello, girls. Act two, fall in love with the parlour maid. Act three, find out she's really Lady Penelope incognito and live happily ever after.
I think I've seen that one.
Oh. What about you? Busy?
Oh, Lord, yes. Yes, Gussie and I are going down to Deverill Hall tomorrow. How do you know them? The Winkworths.
Know them? You're trying to be funny. I'm engaged to Gertrude.
Gertrude? But as in Winkworth?
Of course.
Oh.
What do you mean, oh? She's wonderful, Bertie.
Yes, well, that's good, isn't it?
No, it's not good. When we got engaged and broke the news to her mother, she let out a yell you could have heard in St. Neots.
St. Neots being?
About 20 miles as the crow flies.
Oh, a goodish distance, then.
And I haven't seen Gertrude since. I'm trying to pluck up the courage to go back down there again and persuade her to elope with me.
What's her mother like?
Dame Daphne. Light heavyweight. Touch of Wallace Beery about the jawline.
Oh, dear.
Gus is engaged to her goddaughter.
I'm going to Deverill Hall to get her blessing.
Oh, well, I wish you luck with the aunts.
Aunts?
Dame Daphne's got about 43 sisters living with her. And they let out yells, too.
Oh, dear.
I'll tell you what, Gussie, why don't you take Catsmeat out to dinner? He doesn't eat all that much, and he can enwisen you in Ray these aunts and so forth over the potage. Jeeves. A slight complication has arisen about the dratted Winkworth pill Aunt Agatha is hell-bent on pairing me off with.
Indeed, sir?
Yes, the actor that Dame Daphne is so keen to head off to the pass is Catsmeat Potter-Pirbright. Catsmeat is absolutely balmy about her, apparently. The girl, that is.
That would seem to put you into a somewhat ambiguous situation in regard to your friendship with Mr. Potter-Pirbright, sir.
Ambiguous is right, Jeeves. Well, there's nothing for it, I suppose. I shall just have to throttle right back on the old charm. Don't want to turn the poor girl's head and leave Catsmeat standing at the post.
It would seem to be a danger, sir. Will that be all, sir?
Yes, Jeeves, that'll be all, yes.
Thank you, sir.
I hunted with the East Sussex, of course, but Roger said he felt a certain obligation to support the blasted mid-hands. The consequence was I never saw the little blight at all during the winter.
My poor Hilda.
Any old how, I issued an ultimatum, I'm afraid. Look here, Roger, I said. Either it's the mid-hands or it's me. Take your choice.
Oh, Hilda, you're so courageous.
Yes, well, I haven't seen hide nor hair of him since, and that was 6 weeks ago.
Oh, it isn't fair, is it? I'm so lucky to have a man like Augustus. Strong, reliable.
Whatever happened to that other blighter he used to be keen on, that Bertie Wooster?
Oh, poor Bertie. He's still wildly in love with me, of course. But I had to tell him that there could never be anything between us. My heart belongs to Augustus, you see. Of course, if Augustus and I were ever to break up...
Oh. I told you, don't sing it.
Come on in. I'm pretty handy with my fist, you know. Oh, yeah.
Come on, Gussie.
No, let me get at him.
No, no, we'll go to the Blue Haddock. They'll let you sing there.
Let me get at him.
By now, it was 5 a.m, and we were in Trafalgar Square. Gussie got the idea there might be newts in the fountain and started wading about.
You can't get wading about in Trafalgar Square fountain with all your clothes on.
Well, Gussie did.
Well, he wasn't pinched.
He was. A cop came along and gaffed him. He was given 14 days without the option of Bosher Street Police Court this morning.
Do you know what, Jeeves?
No, sir.
Gussie Fink-Nottle's in stir. Gussie Fink-Nottle's in stir! You see the ghastly position, Jeeves? What is going to happen when Gussie doesn't turn up at Deverill Hall? Madeline will make inquiries. I know what women are like for digging out the truth. And nothing but an idealistic young girl offer fellow more than the news that he's doing 14 days in Chokey.
A very acute observation, sir.
There can be but one result. Gussie will get the bum's rush and the bowed figure you will see shambling down the aisle at Madeline Bassett's side while the organ plays the voice that breathed her Eden will be Bertram Wilberforce Wooster.
Well, I don't see why.
Madeline Bassett labours under the delusion that I'm madly in love with her. Well, when a girl thinks you're in love with her and comes to you and says that she's returning her betrothed to store and is prepared to sign up with you instead, what can you do except marry her? Well, it has to be civil.
There is one possible solution, sir.
You see? There is one possible solution, sir, just like that. For your information, Catsweet, Jeeves takes a size 14 hat, eats tons of fish, and moves in mysterious ways his wonders to perform. Speak, Jeeves.
Well, sir, to obviate the inquiries which would inevitably be set on foot should Mr. Fink-Nottle not present himself at Deverill Hall this evening, it would appear to me to be essential that a substitute purporting to be Mr. Fink-Nottle should take his place.
We're not suggesting that I check in at this plague pit as Gussie.
Unless you can persuade one of your friends to do so, sir.
You can't go around London asking people to pretend to be Gussie Fink-Nottle. Well, at least you can, I suppose, but what a hell of a life. Besides, there isn't even... cat's meat.
Not on, old chap. They all know me at Deverill.
Well, I can't do it. Apart from anything else, I can't even do a possible imitation of Gussie.
You'll pardon me for pointing this out, sir, but the virtue of the plan is that there is no need for you to approximate the look or manner of Mr. Fink-Nottle. Nobody at Deverill Hall has ever seen him.
Yes, but dash it all, Jeeves. They must at least have heard about him. I mean, let's face it, if Gussie's brain were constructed of silk, he'd be hard put to it to find sufficient material to make a canary a pair of cami knickers. 5 minutes conversation with me, and the old folks would penetrate the deception like a dose of salts.
I'm sure that your cool head and undoubted thespian powers will see you through the day, sir.
Jeeves, Jeeves, what are we letting ourselves in for?
I regret to say that I shall not be able to accompany you on this venture, sir.
Not be it? Why on earth not, Jeeves?
I'm sorry, sir. The Ganymede Club would not look kindly on a gentleman's gentleman sailing, as it were, under false colours.
Yeah, that's to say, yes, yes, Fink-Nottle, yes. Well, I'd better be nipping up to dress, what? Don't want to be late for dinner.
Well, dinner has already commenced, sir. We dine at 7:30 punctually at Deverill.
Ah, so straight in and join the fray, you think?
Such were Dame Daphne's instructions, sir.
Right, lead on, then.
Mr. Fink-Nottle has arrived, Dame Daphne.
Oh, good. Oh, the Fink-Nottle, sorry, Fink-Nottle.
Mr. Fink-Nottle, you're very late. You'll have to forego the soup and the fish.
Oh, consider them forewent. Yes.
Well, shall I sit here?
Well, this is jolly.
Allow me to introduce my sisters. Miss Emmeline Deverill, Miss Myrtle Deverill, Miss Harriet Deverill, and Miss Charlotte Deverill.
All the little Deverills, eh? Well, I'm Gussie Fink-Nottle, noted newt fancier.
What did he say? He said he's a newt fancier. Is that why he's so late?
And this is my daughter, Gertrude Winkworth. The nephew of a friend of mine is also meant to be here. I wonder if you know him, a Mr. Wooster.
Bertie Wooster? Oh, yes. Well, I've not actually had the pleasure, but I've heard of him. Well, that's how I know his name, yes.
Apparently, he's completely irresponsible. Agatha says she often wonders if the kindest thing wouldn't be to put in some kind of home.
Well, if that isn't just... Yes, now, I wonder, has everyone heard the one about the fan dancer and the performing flea? No, actually, here's a better one. Yes, there are these three deaf chaps on a train, and it stops at Wembley.
What's he doing? Mr. Fink-Nottle is telling an anecdote.
Anyway, there it is at Wembley, and one of the chaps says, "Is this Wembley?" And the other one says, "No, it's Thursday."
What did he say? He said, "No, it's Thursday." No, it's not. It's Friday. I know, because I changed my library book.
It's a joke, Charlotte.
Thank you. So then the third one says, "So am I. Let's get out and have a drink."
It's a joke about drink, Charlotte.
No, it's not about drink. It's about,
Why did the first man bring up the days of the week? No, the first man is the one who says, is this Wimbledon?
No, Wimbledon. That was the second man.
Let Mr. Fink-Nottle finish his joke before we judge it.
Well, that was it, actually.
Is it about tennis, perhaps?
I don't care for jokes about tennis.
No, except jokes about tennis.
No, I don't care.
Good evening, Sam.
What are you doing here?
I am performing my customary office, Mr. Fink-Nottle, in attending Mr. Wooster.
But, Gussie? You're meant to be in court.
Allow me to help you with that, Mr. Wooster.
What? Oh, yes. Wooster?
You must be Mr. Wooster.
Yes.
I beg your pardon.
No, not me. No, I'm Fink-Nottle, you know, the new man. Never mind good morning. What on earth is going on? How did Gussie get out of stir?
The magistrate decided on second thoughts to substitute a fine for the prison sentence, sir. I was unable to inform you since it happened while you were already on your way here.
So Gussie is freed from Durance Vile and you scoop him up and bring him to Deverill Hall?
Yes, sir.
Why?
It seemed the best possible course of action, sir. In the event of either of you failing to arrive, inquiries would have been instituted by either Mrs. Gregson or Miss Bassett, with disastrous results. To point out just one aspect of the matter, sir, Miss Bassett is expecting daily letters from Mr. Fink-Nottle describing in some detail his life here.
Yeah, well, I hadn't thought of that. So, I'm Gussie and Gussie's me.
Yes, sir.
Well, ceaseless vigilance will be required if we're not to gum up the game with that crew downstairs. We shall be walking on eggshells.
A very trenchant metaphor, sir.
Well, hello, Gussie. Or rather, Bertie.
Well, this is a pretty state of things.
Well, better than being in kink, though, eh?
When you're in prison, at least you don't have people calling you Mr. Wooster. How do you suppose I feel knowing that everybody thinks you're me?
Well, assumed you prefer it.
Prefer it? Are you mad?
Well, how do you think I feel? Do you realise that the little world of King's Deverill is probably going to go to its grave believing that Bertram Wooster is an oversized gargoyle who looks like Lester the Pestering in an American comic strip?
In case you are under any illusion, then let me inform you that those aunts were pulling their skirts aside as I passed when I said I was Bertie Wooster. And, as if that wasn't bad enough, you seem to have made my name mud too. Something about trains and Wimbledon. An unseemly anecdote. They said, what's going to happen if they tell Madeline I go about telling unseemly anecdotes?
I advise stout denial, and in the case it wasn't
about Mr. Wooster? Mr. Fink-Nottle?
Ah, what ho, Dame Daphne?
Gertrude is on the terrace, Mr. Wooster.
Well?
I thought perhaps you might want to talk to her.
What about?
Excuse us just a moment, will you?
Gussie, I am meant to be down here wooing Gertrude Winkworth.
Wooing?
Wooing, courting, pressing one's suit, dallying with.
I'm not going to do that.
But you're going to have to do it, Gussie, because you're meant to be me.
You do your own dirty work. Suppose Madeline found out.
Madeline won't find out. She's miles away in Wimbledon.
Yes, Bertie thinks that after all, you might actually just toss her out onto the terrace and have a quick word with Gertrude, don't you, Bertie?
No.
I'm sure she'd be very pleased to see you.
Well, I...
Yes, almost as pleased as I shall be to see dear old Madeline again. Yes, I've got so much to tell her.
Well, you could... Oh, very well.
What a charming fellow that Bertie Wooster is. He could charm the skin off a rice pudding.
He seems very confused.
Confused? Bertie Wooster? Never, no. One of the keenest minds of his generation.
Hello.
Hello, Mr. Wooster.
I'm Bertie Wooster.
Lovely morning, isn't it, Mr. Wooster?
What is?
The morning, the weather.
Oh.
Do you like newts?
Newts?
I've got... Gussie Fink-Nottle's got lots of newts. I really envy him. It must be really fulfilling to have that many newts.
Morning, Mr. Paddy.
Morning, madam.
There you are, then.
No letter from Augustus, Hilda. I do wish he'd write.
I say, Bertie, what a charming girl.
What? Who?
A Gertrude. Gertrude Winkworth.
Is she?
She wants me to sing tomorrow night.
Sing?
She'd heard from your Aunt Agatha what an expert you are on all this modern dance music. And if she thought I was you, she said I could entertain everyone after dinner tomorrow night.
Well, can you sing, Gussie?
Probably.
What do you mean, probably?
Well, I haven't tried yet, have I? I thought you could teach me a couple of those songs.
Do you play the piano, Gussie?
Yes. I'm better at the oboe.
Really?
Yeah, I think the piano is the more usual sort of thing. Now this is a good one, yes. So shall I just play it through for you? Give you the general idea, then you have a go?
All right.
Right. One, two, three, four.
Some people make a fuss when nothing goes wrong. Some start to swear and cuss, others sing a song. I don't do either, that's all napoo. When nothing goes wrong with me, this is what I do. I lift up my finger and I say toot toot, shush shush, now now, come come. I don't need to linger when I say tweet tweet, shush shush.
Stop! Are you mad? Do you think I'm gonna stand up in front of people and think tweet tweet, ha ha hee hee?
No, the second one's shush shush.
What does it all mean?
Well, it's the absolute denier cree, Gussie. As crees go, this is about as denier as you can get.
It's absolute gibberish.
Well, if you want intellectual content, now this is the one. Right, here we go.
How do you feel when you marry your ideal? Ever so goosey, 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 goosey. How do you feel when the bells begin to peal? Ever so goosey, 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 goosey. Walking up the aisle in a kind of daze. Do you get the wind up when the organ plays? How do you feel when the parson's done the deal? Ever so goosey, 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 goosey.
Oh, I like that. That's very good. Let me have a go. Gertrude will love this.
Oh, she'd have to have a heart of stone. Not... What do you mean Gertrude will love this?
Well, she's the one who wanted me to play. Madeline never wanted me to play.
Well, Madeline doesn't think you're me.
Don't you sometimes feel that Madeline's a bit, well, soppy, Bertie?
Madeline, soppy?
All that business about baby bunny rabbits and the stars being God's daisy chain.
No, Gussie, no. Madeline's beliefs are a bit out of the ordinary, perhaps, but sound, Gussie, extremely sound. No, I think it would be a grave mistake for you to think of her as soppy.
Well, let's get on with it, shall we?
Ah, Jeeves. Sorry to disturb you in your lair.
Not at all, sir.
Well, I don't like the way things are going, Jeeves. Mr. Fink-Nottle appears to be besotted by this Gertrude female.
I feared that this might be the case, sir.
I suppose it's only to be expected. The sudden impact of a girl like Gertrude plum spang in the middle of spring on a fathead like Gussie, weakened through constantly swilling orange juice, must be terrific. But what are we going to do, Jeeves?
I've taken the liberty, sir, of arranging a three-ball this afternoon between Miss Winkworth, Mr. Fink-Nottle, and yourself.
Golf, Jeeves? At a time like this? With Gussie? He's a terrible golfer. Well, I am to know that Gertrude takes her golf very seriously. She plays off six.
Such is my understanding, sir.
Well, she'll see his abysmal putting and his frankly laughable game off the tee, and she'll cast him aside like a split bathish. Jeeves, how could I ever doubt you?
I could not say, sir.
Just where have you been, Mr. Potter-Pirbright?
Me?
Well, after that row with your mother...
That was 3 weeks ago. You haven't telephoned me, you haven't written...
Anyway, I'm here now, and I've decided. I want you to elope with me.
Oh, do you just? Oh, good of you to let me know. Well, you can just jolly well go back to London and...
Cat's meat? Shh! I'm in disguise.
Pathetic, isn't it?
What do you mean, that face fungus? That would fool a parrot. I'm your man.
What do you mean you're my man?
Your valet. It's the ideal way for me to come down here and see Gertrude incognito. My name's going to be Meadows.
Are you mad?
But Mr. Fink-Nottle!
Oh, my God. What's it, Dame Daphne?
Don't I recognize you?
Well, I hope so, yes. I was at dinner last night.
No, you.
No. I'm his man.
Man?
A lackey. Serf. Valet.
Your face seems very familiar.
Yes, but it's that sort of face, you know. You see them all over the shop.
Anyhow, you may go about your business. I want to speak to your master. What's this I hear, Mr. Fink-Nottle?
I beg your pardon?
I've had a telegram from Madeline.
Oh, yes?
Madeline says she has not received a single letter from you since you arrived at the Hall, and she is deeply distressed at your abominable neglect. And I'm not surprised.
Oh, right, yes, well, tell you what, I'll dash off a line as soon as we get back from the golf. How about that?
Please do, Mr. Fink-Nottle.
Right. About you not writing to Madeline.
Madeline?
Do you realize she started sending telegrams about it? For all our sakes, Gussie, write to her.
I am not at all pleased with Madeline. It was she who made me come to this ghastly place. I only consented on the understanding that she'd come too. Then at the last moment, she coolly backed out on the flimsy plea that some school friend of hers needs her. She must be made to realize she can't do that sort of thing. So I'm not going to write to her. It's a sort of a system.
Gussie! For the last time, will you or will you not immediately compose an 8-page letter, breathing love in every syllable, and post it to Madeline?
Not.
Come on, Bertie.
Righto.
What club are you going to use here, Gussie?
Same one. I simply press this button here. Click, it's a niblick. Click, click, it's a mashy niblick. Click, 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 it's a mid-mashy. No further club required. Say goodbye to heavy golf bag misery.
With that new club of yours, Bertie?
No, well, it takes a bit of getting used to. Can't expect just to pick up a club like this.
Here, let me have a go. You can use my clubs for the rest of the round if you like.
Waiting for you.
what does that blasted Fink-Nottle think he's up to?
Gussie Fink-Nottle is a criminal lunatic.
But he seems to be infatuated with Gertrude. Sorry to use such long words, Bertie. I mean, I come all the way down here to try to persuade Gertrude to elope with me, and I can't get near her for that blasted Fink-Nottle.
Worse than that, he says he isn't going to write to Madeline. You know how much importance girls of the Bassett type attach to the Daily Letter?
And he won't write.
Not a line. I've pleaded with him, passionately, I may say, but he simply put his ears back and refused to cooperate. If Madeline doesn't receive a letter from Gussie swearing undying fealty, she's liable to come down here and beat one out of him.
Jeeves, I'm sunk.
Well, sir, if Mr. Fink-Nottle will not write to Miss Bassett, perhaps you might write to her yourself.
Well, she doesn't want to hear from me, Jeeves. She wants to hear from Gussie.
If it were indicated to Miss Bassett that Mr. Fink-Nottle had sprained his wrist and had to dictate a letter to you, sir?
I say, what a wheeze. You were right about him, Bertie.
Thank you, sir. If you were to say that Mr. Fink-Nottle had given his wrist a nasty wrench while stopping a runaway horse and saving a little child from a hideous death, it might turn Mr. Fink-Nottle's taciturnity to your advantage, sir. A golden-haired child is usually best in such circumstances.
What a man, Bertie. What a brain. And all this is due to fish, you say.
Never mind about Jeeves' dyed cat's meat. Writing paper instanter. If Madeline's withers can be rung, we'll just catch the 5 o'clock post. Oh.
Dearest, my dearest, my dearest.
And now for a real treat. Mr. Wooster has kindly consented to entertain us all with some songs at the piano.
Fred to Maud one evening, I wish you'd tell me, dear, how do you feel when you marry your ideal? Ever so goosey, 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 goosey. How do you feel when the bells begin to peal? Ever so goosey, 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 goosey. Walking up the aisle.
Well, if this doesn't bring Gertrude to her senses, nothing will. Good night, Casby. Say, Jeeves, this is dashed decent of you, doing your normal stint as well as pandering to Gussie's every whim.
Oh, Mr. Fink-Nottle's whims are few and far between, sir.
Well, are we surprised, Jeeves? Shut away in Lincolnshire, surrounded by newts, and with nothing to fortify the spirit but orange juice, and nothing to look at but the Boston stump, surely even the strongest whim would wither on the vine.
A lesson to us all, sir. Was the musical entertainment a success, sir?
From our point of view, Jeeves, a blinder. Gussie will shortly be banished to his room, a broken and rejected man.
Do you get the wind up when the organ plays? How do you feel when the path's done the deal? Ever so goosey, 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 goosey.
Isn't he marvellous? He's just like Jack Buchanan.
He is like Jack Buchanan. Yes.
I love Jack Buchanan.
Gertrude says he's like Jack Buchanan, Charlotte.
Oh, is he?
Telegram for Mr. Fink-Nottle. Thank you, Tom.
Right.
Telegram for Mr. Fink-Nottle, Meadows.
Singing was bad enough before,
magic ingredient of stage fright.
It's an absolute calamity, Bertie.
I know, I heard it.
No, you don't understand. They loved it.
What?
Well, you've heard about people being lionized. I often wondered what it looked like, and now I know.
Gussie, but he was making the most frightful row.
Well, the whole grisly crew seemed to think it was wonderful. And Gertrude's all over him, too.
Well, that's it, Jeeves. We're finished. She loves his golf, she loves his singing.
He's got a telegram, too.
We'll be sending telegrams to Gussie.
Well, go on.
Go on what?
Open it.
I can't, Catherine. It's addressed to Gussie.
Well, it's probably for you. Go on.
No, Catsbeat. The code of the Woosters restrains me.
Well, wouldn't restrain me.
No, well, the code of the Woosters is more rigid than the code of the Catsbeats. A Wooster cannot open a telegram addressed to another.
Pardon me for intervening, sir, but perhaps it would alleviate the ethical pressure you find yourself under if I were to open the communication and read it out loud.
Sterling notion, Jeeves.
It's from Miss Bassett, sir. Letter received. Cannot understand why not had reassuring telegram. Sure you concealing accident terribly serious. Fever, anxiety, fear worst. Unless hear from you soon, will arrive by earliest train. Love, kisses, Madeline.
Well, that's...
Gussie, I've got to talk to you.
I'm sorry, Bertie, I haven't got time. There's a lovely full moon. Gertrude and I are going out for a walk. I'm just going to get a muffler. Oh, by the way, you remember pestering me yesterday to write to Madeline? Well, I've done it. I wrote to her this afternoon. Why are you looking like a dying duck?
Because I wrote to her for you yesterday.
What do you mean, for me?
Well, I sort of said you couldn't. You were indisposed. Something about a horse. I forget the details.
A horse? You do the most extraordinary things, Bertie. Anyway, it really doesn't matter, because what I said in my letter was, everything was off.
Off?
I've broken the engagement. I've been feeling for some days now that Madeline, although a nice enough girl, just won't do. My heart belongs to Gertrude. Bye, Bertie.
Housebreaking during the hours of daylight is a most serious offence, sir.
I have got to intercept that letter before Madeline Bassett reads it. You don't have to be involved, Jeeves. You just start the car and keep the engine running.
Very good, sir.
That's lovely.
All right, then. Bye.
Bye, Sam.
Madeline.
Good morning, Hilda. There's no letter from Augustus again. I'm so worried, Hilda. I think I shall go down to Deverill by an earlier train.
If there isn't a letter, all it means is that that other fellow, Wooster, has got fed up with having Gussie dictate letters to him. He's dippy about you, isn't he?
He loves me very, very dearly. It's a tragedy. I can't describe to you, Hilda, the look of dumb suffering in his eyes when we meet. My photograph!
What?
It's not on the table. It's gone.
I expect Jane smashed it. She smashes everything that isn't made of sheet iron.
I'll go and ask her.
Oh, quiet, Pansy. What's the matter, you silly ass? Pansy!
Jane says she... Hilda! Oh, Hilda, what are you doing with that gun?
There's a damned man behind the sofa.
No!
All right, you. Come out with your hands up. No, don't!
Yes.
Mr. Wooster, this is a most horrible crime of which you stand accused. In all my years on the bench, I've never before been called upon to preside over such a case as this. That such a desperate crime could be perpetrated in Wimbledon in broad daylight will bring a shudder to every right-thinking person. Have you anything to say in your defense before I pass sentence?
Well,
he did it for love, Your Honor.
For what?
Love. I am not ashamed to say it.
And who, my dear, are you?
My name is Madeline Bassett. I am the unworthy object of this gentleman's adoration.
He's a very lucky young man, Miss Bassett.
Not so, Your Honor. I am betrothed to another. But Bertie has gone on worshipping me, outwardly gay and cheerful, inwardly gnawed by a ceaseless pain.
Go on.
I ought to have given him my photograph long ago, but I thought it would be too painful for him, Your Honor. A sad reminder of all that he had lost.
No, no,
be quiet.
I see now that I was wrong, Bertie. You found the strain too great to bear. You had to have it, whatever the cost. So, you stole into the house and took it.
You're a very fortunate young man, Mr. Wooster, to have this girlie speak up for you. The case is dismissed.
Oh. No, look here, Madeline.
You must be brave, Bertie. I have to go to Augustus now. He needs me too. Someday, another girl will come into your life, and you will be happy. When we are both old and grey, we shall laugh together over all this. Laugh. But I think with a tear behind the smile. How sad life is.
You betcha. Fetch the car, Jeeves. She's going down to Deverill Hall on the next train. We've got to get there before her.
Very good, sir.
Why? Mrs. Gregson!
Oh, Madeline!
You're not going to Devil too, are you?
I most certainly am, child.
You'll pardon me saying so, sir.
What is it, Jeeves?
The new
needle on the speedometer indicates that we are travelling at 85 miles per the hour, sir.
Good Lord, is that all?
If I might remark on the smell of burning, sir.
Burning?
I'm sure it's no consequence, sir.
That's not burning. That's the good smell of hot oil and pounding pistons. The mighty of cookers, the ideal running temperature of an engine.
Come down, Agatha. Just in time to announce the engagement, I should think.
Oh, Mummy.
Bertie, he is engaged. That's a delightful boy. To Gertrude?
A very perfect, genteel knight.
Abstemious.
There must be some mistake.
Oh, no.
Intelligent?
Surely not.
Ah, oh, Gertrude, I hoped I'd find you.
Gussie, you're all right. Madeline!
Pardon me, Madeline. Would you kindly not touch Bertie in that way? He doesn't like it.
Bertie? What do you mean, Bertie?
It's all Bertie Wooster's fault.
What is happening? Is this man not Bertie Wooster?
Of course he is not Bertie Wooster.
Gussie, what have you been doing?
He said he was going to marry me.
Madeline, I can explain!
No! Oh, what a journey we had. We'd completely gone.
Claude!
Claude! For goodness sake, girl, will you stop crying?
But if he's Fink-Nottle, who's the other one?
Ah, what-ho, Deverill's all.
Claude, I've been such a fool. Oh, of course I'll marry you. Let's leave right away.
Oh, right.
Pardon me, Mr. Potter-Pirbright, but I wonder if I might borrow your moustache.
Sorry, Miss Lodge. I had to pop up to Wimbledon to see dear old Madeline. She's well, you know, very Madeline-ish, if you know what I mean. But then, obviously,
Bertie!
I have to get back to... Aunt Agatha, this is a surprise.
I want an explanation, Bertie. And I want it now.
He said he was Mr. Fink-Nottle.
Oh, yes.
Without even answering.
The thing is, Aunt Agatha...
Yeah. All right, Scotland Yard. I'm looking for one Bertram Wilberforce Wooster.
Scotland Yard?
That's me.
Then I am arresting you, Bertram Wilberforce Wooster, on charges relating to the possession of an illegal golf club. Will you come quietly?
Brilliant. That is brilliant.
Now then, less of that. Let's have no funny business.
Scotland Yard? Oh, the shame of it.
What a wheeze, Jeeves.
I'm glad to have been of service, sir.
You know, Jeeves, if someone were to come to me and ask if I'd be willing to join a society whose aim will be the suppression of arts, or who will at least see to it that they are kept on a short chain and not permitted to roam at will, scattering desolation on all sides, I'd reply, Wilbraham, if his name was Wilbraham, that is, Wilbraham, put me down as a foundation member.
I'm sure such a society would not be lacking for subscribers, eh?